Good afternoon. I just wanted to give you all a chance to settle down with the food on the basis of the old adage, which I'm sure many of you know, that think tanks are three quarters about catering, one quarter about thinking. So we recognize the importance of provisions. It's a great pleasure, privilege for me, my first event as Director of Policy Exchange, to be able to introduce two very dear friends. There's a tremendous symmetry in this because both men have been critical to the transatlantic dialogue and exchange of ideas that policy exchange embodies. Danny Finkelstein, our chairman, will be known to all of you as executive editor of The Times, key columnist there, who's been bringing the very best of American thought to these shores for many years, both from the think tank world, the wider world of sociology, political science, and economics. David Frum, another very dear friend, has been at the forefront of taking the very best of British experiences as part of his own vision of modernizing the American center-right, and was the very first commentator on the other side of the Atlantic to extol David Cameron's vision as aspects of it as a potential model for the modernization of the American center-right. David, as many of you will know, is contributing editor to Tina Brown's site, The Daily Beast. He's also a trustee of American Friends of Policy Exchange, and perhaps most important, he is a key thinker and the author, most recently, of the reasons why George Romney lost the last election, and it's the lessons thereof that are particularly exciting him to today, and it's why he's going to engage in dialogue with Danny to tease out what the real lessons of last November are for the United States and the lessons for all of us across the Atlantic. David and Danny, thank you.
It was highly characteristic for you to have such acute and detailed knowledge of American politics that you called Mitt Romney George. We are very pleased to have you, David. Obviously, we've been long-term soulmates, Policy Exchange and you. One could start almost anywhere. So you'll excuse me for diving into, what is really the middle. And that is Mitt Romney's defeat. So you wrote a book called Why Romney Lost, which was published very shortly after the election, suggesting that you anticipated that your efforts writing such a book wouldn't be wasted, which implies that you thought the reasons were kind of systematic. So perhaps we might start just by asking the question, why did Romney lose?
All right. Well, Danny, thank you. Thank you all to Policy Exchange. And Dean, thank you for that introduction. I've known Dean since, I'm embarrassed to say, 1986. And it is just wonderful to see him assume the leadership of this important institution. I mean, there's no one I know who thinks more profoundly about politics than Dean Godson, unless it is you, Danny. And I'm very excited to be now on the board of the American Friends and to be able to support the extraordinarily important work of your institution as you govern, which is such a refreshing contrast to what is happening on our side of the Atlantic. Why did Mitt Romney lose? Just the story of that book was published as a digital book. The election was the first Tuesday in November, and the book was published shortly after midnight on Thursday morning. Obviously, I did not write the book in 36 hours. Publishing in that way was kind of a publicity device, I admit that, but here's why I did it. During the campaign, you are pressed, if you're a member of the pundit class, to make predictions. I think predictions are in many ways the least important of the things we do in political journalism, but that's there is this enduring market for it. The problem is that the human mind naturally finds it very difficult to tell the difference between what you predict will happen and what you wish will happen. So if you say in October or September, I expect President Obama to win, people will accuse you, especially if you are a Republican and conservative, of being a Cassandra, of wishing ill to your party. So I made a lot of effort. I think I was almost unanimously, almost consistently successful to evade that question. On the other hand, I was vain enough that I did want people to know that I'd been right. And this seemed the way to do it after the fact rather than before the fact. There are two narratives prevalent among American Republicans as to why Romney lost, and both are wrong. The first prevalent narrative blames it on technology and organization, and and President Obama did indeed put together a much superior organization. But to my way of thinking, that is another way of restating the problem, because the Republicans don't lack money, they don't lack talent. Why did President Obama have a better organization? That's not a sufficient answer. And his superior organization was yet another manifestation of the problems that the Republican Party had. The second theory that is prevalent in the Republican Party is the focus on immigration. It says that Mitt Romney lost because the Republicans had a hardline view on immigration. And I understand this view gets a lot of publicity in the British press because it is readily then applied to your own controversies. Where there are people who want it to be understood that a hard line on immigration is a vote loser. But this explanation, too, is not right. What we have seen is it's not even logical. When you think about when the Hispanic American vote, the largest components of it are Mexican American and Central American. These are lower income people, lower levels of education. They are people who are right now ineligible for government programs, or federal programs anyway, because of their citizenship status. But if they were citizens, they would be eligible for programs and they would benefit from them and they would enjoy them and support them. So it would be just unreasonable to expect them to vote against their pocketbooks. Everybody else in the country votes for their pocketbooks. Why should they be any different? It is just unlikely that you're going to get a very large percentage of the Hispanic vote. And the Republican share of the Hispanic vote is naturally going to decline over time as the Hispanic vote becomes less Cuban and more Central American and Mexican. Ronald Reagan did very well with the Hispanic vote in 1980, but in 1980, Hispanic meant overwhelmingly or disproportionately Cuban. Today, Cubans are a very shrinking part of the Hispanic vote. My argument is that Mitt Romney lost because of the failure of the Republican Party to articulate a middle-class economic message relevant to the lives of the center of the American voter. He also lost because he had a social and cultural message that was plainly reactionary. And this is not just about the complex of issues about the rights of same-sex couples or of the quite repugnant things that some candidates had to say about women and their reproductive freedom and abortion. It went deeper to a strong message of exclusion of many people. The notorious 47% remark, the most important thing to understand about that remark is that it was not a gaffe. A gaffe occurs when a politician at a microphone says, "I'm pleased to be with you here today in Iowa," and he's really in Ohio. Or when he says, "I'm pleased to be here with you today in Ohio," and then he puts his hand over the microphone and thinks nobody can hear us, and he says, "I hate Ohio." That's a gaffe. But when you say President Obama gets the votes of the 47% of the population that are takers, he is repeating out loud a powerful idea that has been repeated on many public occasions by other figures in the party, including his running mate. And that after the election, many Republicans among themselves have cited as a cause of their defeat. He is saying, now it happens to be both intellectually wrong and morally wrong. That is not the reason why the Republican Party lost. But it manifests that the party's detachment from that middle-class economic message. It manifests the message of cultural exclusion. And one more sentence, because this is too long an answer. It is important to understand, too, that this is not a one-time event. That the defeat in 2012 was the culmination of deeper trends. There are six elections from 1968 to 1988. In those six elections, Republicans lost one, 1976, and on one occasion, 1968, there was a three-way split in the vote. George Wallace ran as an independent candidate. Despite that, if you include the defeat and if you include the three-way split, in those six elections, the Republican Party averaged about 52.5% of the vote. There have been six elections since 1988 In only one election, 2004, did the Republicans win even a majority. And that one majority was at a lower level of the vote than their average of six, between 68 and 88. So something happened in 1988. 1988 is the last year that the Republicans win New Jersey. It's once a Republican stronghold. It's the last year that the Republicans win Pennsylvania. It's the last year the Republicans win California. And the real story of what has gone wrong for the Republicans is not their struggle to hold on to the vote of Hispanic Americans. It is the collapse of their vote among educated Americans, people with a four-year college degree, and especially women with a four-year college degree.
Okay, so one of the big debates in among conservative modernizers in this country is to what extent you want to put an emphasis on social liberalism, effectively believing in a modern Britain, and the other, to what extent you want to put an effort on defeating the idea that the Conservative Party is only for the rich.
Yes.
The second of those has been made significantly more difficult by the fact that it's very difficult to square the economic circle. It's very difficult simultaneously to reduce the deficit, which is an important overall message and necessary to do, and to somehow redistribute the money towards the middle, which is, of course, the largest group. How will the Republican Party ever be able to do that? How can conservatives here solve that problem?
Well, on this question, I think we need to have quite a sharp distinction between British and American circumstances, which are very different. The most important difference is debt and deficits are much less dangerous to an economy the size of America than to an economy the size of the United Kingdom. And also, America started at a much lower level of debt and deficit than Britain did. So, if I may bracket the British experience and talk only about the American, there's a model of reporting that has become very familiar, I'm sure you do it on this side of the Atlantic, that used to distinguish the struggle in the Republican Party as that between crazy social conservatives and sensible economic conservatives. What we have seen since 2009 was it was possible to have very extreme and impractical views among the economic conservatives. That's the big change that happened after the defeat of 2008, is the economic conservatives decided that their economic views, that the economic issue was a culture war. In fact, the leader of one of the major think tanks said, the economic war is our culture war. And they then turned it into, this is where the origin of this idea of makers versus takers of the 47% came. It was an aggressive act to come up with a new and much more strident economic message. In the American context, I would say the answer is this. First, curbing the deficit is simply not as important in the United States as it is in Britain. Second, the deficit is already shrinking remarkably quickly. One of the things that is really startling when you talk to American Republicans, basic facts about the economy of the country, things that you can look up on the websites of the federal government, are not only controversial, they are rejected. I mean, if I were to say to a room full of Republicans that the American the budget deficit is shrinking each quarter at the fastest rate since the end of the Korean War, they would say that's not true. But it is true. You can look it up. In the same way, in 2009, I would say there is no inflation. They would say that's not true. But it is true. You can look it up. It's not what the inflation rate is. It's not my opinion. It is computed. And post it for all to see. And if you have a theory as to why the number is wrong, you can try arguing with the people whose job it is, but you're not arguing with me. So we have the deficit coming down very rapidly. But we have a real generational crisis in the employment prospects and the life chances, especially of the young. And as the Republican Party has become a more and more elderly party, it has become quite contemptuous of the problems of the young. Quite contemptuous of the young in general. And this is a sociologist, Theda Sockpol of Harvard, did a really interesting book about the Tea Party. And one of the themes in her interviews, and she has extraordinary quotations, is the disregard that the Tea Party people have for the younger generation, including literally their own children and grandchildren. We, in the United States, we have one other, I wouldn't call it an advantage, but we have one other fact that shapes our economic policy, which is when you have the most wasteful healthcare system in the world, that the job of dealing with your expenditure problems, you have a lot more low-hanging fruit than in Britain. The United States spends about 17% of national income on healthcare. It gets some of the worst results in the developed world. It's just to put that in context, the United States spends 17% of GDP on healthcare. Britain spends about 10. As it happens, the worst year for the budget deficit, the deficit was 7% of GDP. Now, you can't simply pick up 7 points over here and move them over there, but the identity of those two quantities is suggestive, at least. So we have, what I would say, that when you think about what the Republicans should be doing, they should be focusing on healthcare cost control. They should be focusing on a tax approach that worries more about relieving the middle than about relieving the top. They should look for economic growth, not from further tax cuts at the top, which won't work, which didn't work during the Bush years, but on deregulation. They should, that controlling healthcare costs itself would be a major spur to economic growth. When you have healthcare costs at 17%, healthcare then becomes this all-pervading fact. It's like pork in the Monty Python game show quiz. It's the answer to every public policy problem. And it would be a huge relief to businesses and to tax, people would have more disposable income if those costs could be controlled. One more example of this. One of the great problems we have is we have ceased to make progress in the proportion of young people who complete a four-year degree. We're graduating from university now about the same percentage of our young people as we graduated in the early 1980s. One important reason for that is the cost of college and the burden of debt. People cannot actually afford to complete their degrees. Why are college costs so high? There are a lot of reasons, but one important reason is that the proportion of state government budgets that go to higher education is shrinking. And it's shrinking, if you look at the growth in what state governments spend on Medicaid, the shared cost healthcare program between the federal government and the states, the rise, the curve, that upward curve, and then you look at the downward curve in state support for higher education, it looks like the map of Brazil and North Africa. I mean, it just looks like these two things are one thing, and they have scrimped on higher education in order to fund rising healthcare costs. And that is another cause of the slow growth we've suffered since the beginning of the century.
So one of the things I'm interested in discussing with you is to what extent these arguments have gained traction from the defeat of Mitt Romney. So the interesting thing that to me watching the election was that good friends of mine who I respected were a few days from the election of Obama predicting that Romney would win, even right. though the opinion polls suggested there was like a 97% chance that wouldn't happen, and they just kind of started arguing with the opinion polls instead. Right. Now that has happened against their expectation, has it prompted a rethink in the Republican Party, and how is that going, basically? How serious is it?
I want to break your question into two parts, because you raised two separate but extremely interesting issues. Let me take first the reaction and then talk about why people were so wrong in their predictions, because that it was more than just wishful thinking that explains that mistake. After the defeat in 2008, there was what I call a great brain freeze. The party became fell into the grip of what I called "say it louder" conservatives. The only reason that the voters had rejected our message was we weren't taught, like the stereotypical British tourist in a foreign land, we weren't speaking English loudly enough. If you just speak it loudly enough, then they will understand. It turns out, no, they still don't understand. Or actually, they understand all too well. They completely, and the louder and clearer and more distinct you were, the less they liked what you were saying. The party then went on this veering Tea Party detour. Since 2012, there has been, I wouldn't say a rethink or a renaissance or anything like that, but there has been a little bit of a thaw, and the freeze is beginning to melt. You can begin to say things. I mean, I've been saying them for 4 years, but it hasn't done anybody else any good and hasn't done me any good either. But since 2012, people can begin to articulate some of the elements. Now, it's very early days. There are a lot of people who continue to say the problem, that the Republicans had exactly the right message, the problem is the country. That the American people, the problem was that the American people were too grasping and greedy, and they didn't recognize the rightness of our message, and now the country is heading to doom because people obstinately refuse to accept the correct answer. I hope this process will continue, but it's extraordinarily slow. And even when Republicans begin to articulate, yes, we do need a more middle-class economic message, then they tell you what that message is, and you say, but that's not at all a middle-class economic message. One of the things that the Romney people often talked about, for example, was bringing having cuts in the top rate of tax while paying for it by eliminating tax deductions. And they would say, after all, we will then keep balance between, that this will be distributionally neutral because it only will affect the burden of taxes within the top. The top 2% of the population will pay no less as a group. Which the answer is that's right, the top 2% will pay no less, but the top 2% in the United States starts at about $250,000. So what you're doing is shifting the burden of tax from people who make over $1 million to people who make $250,000. And it's true, you're neutral within the top 2%, but shifting it from the hedge fund owners to their accountants, that's going to produce a reaction, because the accountants are also a very important part of American society and the Republican coalition. So. Early, but starting. Now, ask your question as to why people were so wrong. This is quite interesting, because it tells you something about the psychopathology that overtook the way Republicans think about things. When, I don't talk about Dick Morris and flim-flam men like that, but when people like Michael Barone and Karl Rove, serious and intelligent observers of American politics, were so massively and publicly wrong, they had a reason for it. And here's what they did. Was if you start in the middle 1980s, you can see the share of the votes that are cast by white Americans moves downward at a very steady pace. Election after election, I forget now what it is, it's like a point and a quarter, but it drops. It's a perfectly, it forms a perfectly predictable line. Until you get to 2008 when there's a deviation because of the big increase in black voter turnout for Barack Obama in 2008, that this steady slope suddenly plunges. So the question that you ask is, what will happen in 2012? Will the steady slope resume from the 2008 point? Does the drop from 2008, from 2004 to 2008, does that represent a new slope? Or will we revert to trend? Is 2008 a blip? And all the people who are wrong said, we will not only revert to trend, but we will revert even above trend. Because what will happen is because black America, because we all know Barack Obama is a terrible president, and black America knows it too, but they can't admit it out loud for reasons of ethnic pride. But in their hearts they know, and so they will stay home. And so what will happen is that we will not move on, the trend that has been in place since the 80s will not continue, it will revert, because white America will come out in its righteous wrath to deal justice to this intolerable president, and black America will quietly admit that they had made a terrible mistake. Now, when you articulate it, you think, that sounds crazy. That's not what's going to happen. But that was the thinking that led people to insist. And so, you know, you had to say, what you're saying is that black Americans will not come out for Barack Obama in 2012. And what you're also saying is that Latino Americans have given up on him. And both of those things, I can demonstrate to you in all kinds of ways are false. And that's why I was able to start work on my book in September, although I have to say the thing that made me absolutely certain was the 47% remark. I mean, you cannot say that about the voters and expect to survive. And I was interviewed on TV the night after the election, and I was asked for my advice for Republicans in just one sentence. And I said, insult fewer people next time.
Yeah, I always used to say that was the Conservative Party's sort of rule was to say, dear so-and-so, we don't like you from the Conservative Party, and it was part of losing the 1997 election. Do you think the reason why it was possible for people to take that view is because there's a kind of like an ecosystem of Republican news? I mean, you can just watch that.
Yes. And you can when Hugh Grant got into his sex scandal, it was a decade ago, he went on The Tonight Show to make his apology, and he was interviewed by Jay Leno, and Leno asked him how he could have gotten so far away, removed from reality. And he said, well, you have to understand, I employ people to lie to me. And that's what happened. That's what, you know, that when you live in a country where the media is biased to the left, that's a problem. That is an objective political problem. But a right of center party that lives in an environment where the media are tilted to the left is like a sprinter who trains at higher sea level and then competes at lower sea level. Suddenly, there's all that he trains under more and more adverse conditions. And then when it's time to perform, he has all of this extra lung capacity. But when you compete, when you live, as Republicans now do, in a media environment where you are never challenged, where if you want to believe that there is inflation, there is a media source that will tell you there is inflation, even though there isn't, you do get systematically distorted. And the worst thing that happens is that even those politicians who would like to engage more in reality cannot. Because in the stage of the campaign where you're winning nominations, you're talking to the faithful, you're raising money, that you're consistently talking to audiences that believe things about the world that are not true. And if you, and they are not, it's one thing for a pundit to tell them that they're wrong. And I've had this experience. If I leave the room, I don't have to worry that much if they haven't liked anything I've said. I'm not asking them for money, I'm not asking them for votes, I'm not asking them to do anything. But if you are asking them to do something, you cannot walk into a room full of people and tell them your basic suppositions about the world are false. It's not true that there's inflation. It's not true that the reason public spending is so high is that greedy young people and minorities are taking all the money. In fact, if any group of people in the country are taking all the money, it's you, that the Republican Party is the party of the over 65s. You're the takers, because the United States spends 7 times as many federal dollars on the care of people over 65 as it does on people under 18. And even if you look at state and local dollars, because education is a state and local responsibility primarily, it's still a 4-to-1 ratio for people over 65. That's where the money goes. It goes to the Republican Party base. But they don't believe that. And no one ever tells them otherwise. And in fact, the media sources that they like most tell them the contrary and tell it to them over and over and over again.
I'm sure you sort of modesty will prevent you from kind of giving a full answer, but
don't count on it.
I know you well enough. My view is that you've been very brave, really, because you kind of had a very secure position inside this kind of Republican and conservative world, and you've risked it in order to tell people what they don't want to hear. You might just tell people a little bit about what that experience has been like.
Well, that doesn't require lack of modesty. That requires willingness to complain. There's a play by Eugene Ionesco called Rhinoceros, which is set in this small town of the south of France. And people in the town begin, one by one, to transform into rampaging rhinoceroses, until finally the only person who is left is the town drunk, who does not turn into a rhinoceros and is now left to wonder, what's wrong with me that everyone else was transformed into a rampaging rhinoceros and I didn't? And through a lot of the period since 2008, one has had that experience of, and it happens often with dear friends, that they will say things like, we're living in the last days of the American Republic. And you say, no. And what also, the thing that is really disturbing about this, of course, is you realize it is a reflection of how old you and your friends are getting. I mean, I turned 50 in 2010, and for me, the future holds decline leading to extinction. And it is very natural, when that's what the future holds for you, to believe, well, that's what the future holds for everybody else, because it would be really hateful to think that shortly after I pass from this veil of tears, things are going to begin to get really good. They're going to cure Alzheimer's. They're going to extend life to 200 years. They're going to bring in video games with anti-gravity surfboards where you can, and none of that will be available to me. I worked in the Bush administration, and which was, what did the Emperor Hirohito say at the end of World War II? That events did not proceed altogether to the advantage of Japan? I would say the Bush administration was not altogether a success. And so I spent a lot of time worrying about why that was so. My Bush administration colleagues didn't accept it. Do you know how many Bush administration officials does it take to change a light bulb? There's nothing wrong with that light bulb. So I began writing after the 2004 election, which was a very, that Karl Rove was saying it portended a huge realignment. And when you look more closely at the numbers, you realize, no, it was a near-death experience. The reason Republicans won was because they raised their share of the white non-college vote to almost two-thirds, the highest level ever. But every other category except non-college white, college whites, you know, every other form of minority group, their vote was declining. And their vote was declining very steeply among educated whites, and especially among educated white women. And you knew that the share of the vote of the population that is non-college white is shrinking, both because the white share of the vote is shrinking and because whites are rapidly becoming better educated, as the least educated part of the white population is the oldest, and so it falls off the demographic edge every 4 years. And it just tells you 2008, no matter what, even if it's a favorable environment for incumbents, it's going to be a very tough election. So I began writing in 2005, a book that was published in 2007, urging Cameron-style changes. At that point, it was pre-crisis, and the most important changes seemed to me to make were cultural, the detoxification process. Then came the economic crisis and the defeat, right, which is even worse than one would have thought before the crisis. Then came the great debate over healthcare, which Republicans believed they could win entirely. That what they would do is they would prevent the healthcare bill, and this would, just as happened in 1994, the defeat of the healthcare bill would shatter Democratic morale and lead to a catastrophic Democratic defeat. And I kept writing, but the Democrats have also seen that movie. They know that's what happens, and so, and they have the votes. So they will pass something. It is predictable they will pass something. History will not repeat itself. It is important, but they are desperate to negotiate. And I had sources inside, you know, some of the Senate committees. They were desperate to negotiate, and they wanted Republican buy-in. Not only were they desperate to negotiate, but they had laded the bill with things that were calculated to be obnoxious to Republicans in order to trade them away, not in order to do them. But they didn't want to do these things. They didn't want to finance the bill entirely with upper income taxes. They put that in order to force Republicans to do business with them. But when Republicans then boycotted it and refused, all of those terrible elements of the bill remained in the law. So when the bill finally did become law, I wrote a blog post that said we have to hold to account the people who called for the hard line, because they had said they would break the Obama presidency. Instead, they have achieved, they have passed into law this bill in its full terrible form. And they say, well, now we'll win the election in 2010, to which I say, well, that may be right, but it doesn't matter, because the bill is here forever. And they say, no, we'll repeal it. I no, you won't. Anyway, I wrote this probably a more pungent form than was wise. And it's one of those blog posts that, you know, then 2 hours later has been read by 8 million people. And 2 hours after that, the Wall Street Journal has published an editorial denouncing me by name. And the first thing next morning, the head of my think tank calls me in for a chat. And Thursday, I have a lot more leisure hours.
Let's just move on to discussing, you know, and I'm not sure how, and you know a lot about British politics, and I noticed that you were even blogging about the Liberal Democrats and their travails this week. So you follow it quite carefully. But so I wonder what your reflections were now. I mean, obviously, when David Cameron's sort of project was at its height, it's easier for you to be able to cite it. Now that it's got, you know, real political difficulties, has that become a problem for your advancing, modernizing ideas in America?
Well, the American conservatives never liked David Cameron to begin with. No. It was never a powerful argument to say, look at the British conservatives. What has been interestingly more powerful is to say, look at the Canadian conservatives, because Stephen Harper, Prime Minister of Canada, whose heart really does lean to the right, has done many of the same, different, I mean, political situations are different, but has had an extraordinary success reaching out to non-white minority groups. And the conservatives in Canada, the largest non-white group are East Asians. Of Canadians who speak Cantonese at home, they voted 2-1 for the Canadian Conservatives in the last election. Of Canadians who speak Mandarin at home, they voted a majority for the Conservatives in the last election. And the reason I know that is because the Canadian Conservatives have such a sophisticated form of ethnic outreach that they poll separately Cantonese-speaking Chinese and Mandarin-speaking Chinese. And they understand that Punjabis are not the same as Gujaratis, and that they treat India and China as if they were Europe, and they understand that you can't talk about the European vote, that the historical experience of Southern Europeans is different from that of Northern Europeans, and they vote in different ways in the New World. But here, not to tell you about your own political system, but let me deliver a lesson from the American experience for the British. Should it happen that the Conservatives lose power in 2015 or whenever the next election is supposed to be, there will be powerful voices that will call on the party to recoil upon its base, to go back to basics. Please don't listen. Because there is this horrible rule, it seems to be a rule of thumb in the political world, that parties are never satisfied only to lose one election. That they want to lose the next election by more. So you lose with Nixon in 1960, you nominate Barry Goldwater in 1964. You lose with Hubert Humphrey in 68, you nominate McGovern in 72. You lose with Jim Callahan in 79, you try Michael Foote in 1983. Say it louder, isn't it? But what you need instead is to do a much more sophisticated inventory of what you did right and what you did wrong. And you know, God bless the people who are with you in good times and bad times. They are important and should be listened to. But when you lose, what you need to listen to even more are the people who are only with you in good times. Because they are the people you need to win back for the next good time. So it may be that there are, you know, in the countryside, loyal, committed conservatives who are angry because Cameron did not take you out of the European Union, or angry because they don't like the same-sex marriage vote. But they won't be the reason you lose power if you do. You will lose power precisely because the people who are not committed to you. You have to figure out how to win them back. Let me add one more caution to the way you consume American news. When people report on the United States, they will often use the words independent and moderate, as if they are the same thing. So you hear about polling results of independents and polling results of moderates. And you'll hear things like, Rand Paul scores very well with independents, and therefore people like Frum who say we need to move to the center are wrong. The important thing to understand about American politics is that the Republican Party is in so much trouble that it is shrinking from the right edge as well as from the center. So a lot of those independents are people who were intense Republicans, who have now disaffiliated from the Republicans for not being right-wing enough, but who will still vote Republican in the general election. They have given up the name, but they have not given up the thing. If you poll them for advice about where to go, it is like polling UKIP members for advice about where the conservatives should go. Which is not to say they're not worthy of some attention and respect. They are. But that's not the nature of the problem. The problem for your study of American politics is people who call themselves centrists now identify with the Democratic Party. So you have ultra-right-wing independents who think one way, and you have partisan Democrat centrists who need to be pulled back. And the challenge for Republicans is to slice off a big piece of the Democratic Party and pull it back to them. One of the things that is most bizarre about present-day American politics is towns like Greenwich, Connecticut, one of the wealthiest towns in the United States, are overwhelmingly now Democratic. Knowledge industries, Silicon Valley, entrepreneurs in every area except finance. Again and again, you find where Republicans should be strong, they are not. That is where you find new Democrats, and those people have to be won back. Don't repeat the Tea Party mistake. It is a detour, and it's a costly detour. And not only it takes you more than one election because it culturally brands you in a way that is obnoxious, not only to the voters you must win, but to a whole generational cohort who will then go through the early part of the rest of their lives with a very negative impression about who the party is and what it stands for.
So one thing before I throw it open, who's the champion for this in America? Is it Marco Rubio?
The Republicans tend to think that the answer to their problems is a who, and I would say the answer is a what. That it's no good identifying candidates because even if you start with somebody good, we will turn him into somebody bad. But so far the and then there's this other very unhealthy dynamic, which is the one candidate who has been most sort of experimental with new ideas is Chris Christie, the governor of New Jersey. But once you expect people, well, he was just disinvited from CPAC, the annual conservative gathering. He's the one Republican governor who will not, he's the most popular Republican in America. He has a 74% approval rate in his state, a state with 14 electoral votes that Republicans have not won since 1988. And he is, and what people say is, he's not a conservative. That is, the moment you begin to do anything that could bring the movement and the party to health, you are deemed, it's just stipulated, therefore there is nothing to learn from you. So what happens to somebody like Marco Rubio is that he wants to be seen as stylistically new, but he will not be allowed, and he's not allowing himself, to be in any way substantively new. And by the way, if the idea that Marco Rubio will appeal to Hispanic voters is just flatly wrong. It's just completely, it's another one of those things where you don't have to take my word for it, you can look it up. When they test approval ratings of politicians, they break it down by ethnic groups. And Chris Christie has a higher approval rating among Hispanic Americans than Marco Rubio does, for a couple of reasons. The first is that Marco Rubio is too right-wing for Hispanic Americans. Hispanic Americans are heavily go without health insurance. They want health insurance. They want a health insurance answer, and he hasn't got one. And the second problem is Republicans, I talked about the Canadian conservatives understanding that Cantonese speakers are different from Mandarin speakers. Republicans do not understand that Cubans are different from Mexicans. And that the belief that by nominating a light-skinned, middle-class, Cuban-American politician from Florida, that you will therefore do well with Mexican-Americans in California. I keep thinking it's like the Republican Party deciding in 1948 that we need to do better among Eastern European voters in Chicago, therefore we'll put an Ashkenazi Jew on the head of the ticket. They're from Eastern Europe, and all those Croatians and Ukrainians, they'll just love them.
Okay. Now's the chance for everyone else to have a chance to look. And the lady there.
Just wait. And if you could, it would be great to have a name and if there's an affiliation, an affiliation as well.
You raise a lot.
Yes, I was John Paulson's partner at the hedge fund.
You raise a lot of very rich issues, and let me deal quickly with one, and then a little bit more substantial with the other. The first is, no, the Tea Party people are not voting against their economic interests. Remember, we do have universal health coverage in the United States for people over 65, and the Tea Party is drawn overwhelmingly from people over 65. What they were really voting for was to deny health care to others in order to protect their own health care. Whatever else you accuse them of, a lack of sufficient self-interest is not one of them. But the United States must be a two-party system. So long as we have the Electoral College, there can only be two candidates for president. Unless you were to have a third-party candidate who was Dwight Eisenhower, so overwhelmingly popular that person could win a plurality of the vote distributed in the right way among the states. But the consequence of the Electoral College is that if you vote for the candidate you, in a three-way split, if you vote for the candidate you like most, you end up helping the candidate you like least, as every Democrat who voted for Ralph Nader can attest. So the presidency is a two-way race. And because the parties are organized around, all the way down to county commissioner, around presidential contests, it's a two-party system, and therefore parties can't split. The need is not to eliminate the Tea Party. The need is to, one, teach the Tea Party some realism about what can be accomplished. And we've had the beginnings of that. And the second is for non-Tea Party Republicans to organize in a more self-conscious way. The problem with the Republican Party is not that the conservatives are too strong. The problem, the deeper problem, is that the modern conservatives, the modern Republicans, are too weak. And one of the things I'm spending now a lot of time doing is trying to organize modern conservatism as a self-conscious network, first as a network, then to build institutions. There needs to be a modern Republican equivalent of CPAC. There needs to be a modern Republican equivalent of National Review. Where they say, look, we don't deny that you are legitimate parts of the party. You have to cease denying that we are legitimate parts of the party. You have to quit telling us to go vote for President Obama, because sooner or later some of us will, and then where will you be? If you go to a Caribbean island, that you'll see these T-shirts they sell, the floggings will continue until morale improves. The Tea Party in these things, the party will shrink until victory is achieved. That you need to make your party bigger. But that includes holding on to your right edge, as the conservatives here must do, while growing at the middle and bringing back people like you.
Hi, Tony Borden. I wondered if you could address the geographic question, just how that cuts with your socioeconomic analysis. Because if you looked at the map on San Juan tonight, it was blue states and red states. But when they flipped it over to districts,
yeah,
it was all red, with just urban areas totally blue. First question. Second question, you said that when you come up in the party with solutions for the Republican Party, you're no longer in it. Have you been tempted?
Have I attempted to propose solutions?
Have you been tempted? Have you questioned your own opinions?
No, there's another whole talk about what is wrong with the Obama administration and its plans for America. I mean, that I take that as given, that the Obama administration wants to lower America's profile in the world. It is mistrustful of the legitimacy of American power. It is neglectful of the sources of American power. Its plans involve a level of state spending and government control that will have very long-term detrimental consequences to innovation and entrepreneurship. I mean, I'm not a Democrat, I'm not a liberal. So that's why I am where I am, because what one of the things I can say is the people who accuse me of not being sufficiently enraged about Obama, I said they are the people who made him president. Don't blame me. The one thing I have not touched on this talk that maybe is relevant here is that the degree of reckless behavior in Congress. The tactical extremism has become a huge negative consequence. The thing that has tested my patience most is actually not even the substantive views of the Tea Party. It is the willingness to use national bankruptcy as a tool of politics. That is utterly unacceptable. And yet we've seen that we came very close in the summer of 2011, and it looks like we're having another try at it in the spring of 2013. That's just utterly unacceptable. You don't use that as a political tool, and that has driven a lot of people away. As to your point about the counties, rocks don't vote. People vote. And it is not true that the Democratic vote is all concentrated in central cities. It only looks that way because the United States is so big. That it's hard to tell. It's hard to realize that speck that looks like New York City. That's not New York City. That's not Manhattan Island you're looking at. That is the entire mouth of the Hudson, one of the greatest concentrations of population and wealth and talent on the planet. And that's the 25 million people who live within 100 miles or thereabouts, live within 100 miles of New York. That's not a central city. That's a population complex. You know, it's true, the Scottish National Party does very well in UK if you eliminate London and every major metropolitan area in Great Britain. People vote, not rocks. One more thing about this. There are, the exception used to be that major population concentrations in at least the Sun Belt were Republican. That is ceasing to be true. Republicans are running into trouble in places like Dallas and Houston. And not only because of the increase in the Hispanic vote, but because places, as knowledge industries spread through the country, knowledge workers, no matter how affluent, except in the financial industry, knowledge workers are increasingly uncomfortable with the Republican Party. So North Carolina is competitive because Republicans are losing in the research triangle where so much of our pharmaceutical innovation takes place. Well, how can you be a party of enterprise when you are winning in the areas of the country where people are most suspicious of modern capitalism? You're going to pull me deep into deeper waters of British politics than I can go, because I admit I don't keep quite as current with the sayings and doings of Ed Miliband as his more devoted admirers might do. But from what little I know, and forgive me if I don't, that Miliband seems to be pursuing the classic conservative, classic risk-averse play during a major economic downturn of keeping a low profile and letting the government defeat itself. Then I would need to know more about whether or not he's putting up barriers to the party, to letting the governing party defeat itself. But it may be that takes me into areas beyond what I know. It is not all invariably true that parties throw away the next election. It's just, as I said, it's a temptation and a tendency that you observe quite often.
What I'm really interested in is how over the next 3 or 4 years you and your likes are going to help build up the intellectual muscle, and even more important, the ability to communicate those thoughts and ideas consistently and sufficiently engagingly to actually start making a difference.
Okay.
And if I can just observe, I mean, on this side of the Atlantic, we've got a government that is reasonably economically liberal and reasonably socially liberal. And before the election, that was just about being articulated, having done it for about 10 years. And 2.5 years into power, almost nobody recognizes that that's what it is, so it is manifestly that. So if it's difficult now, how much more difficult it is for you? And yet I'm a complete optimist. And I do think that actually intelligent articulation does help.
Well, intelligent articulation is better than what we've had a lot of in the United States, which is its opposite. But here's the program. Here's the plan, I think. This is where the United States is very unlike the United Kingdom. I mean, you can gather 15 people in a Notting Hill living room and say, we think the future of the party should be in this direction. And those 15 people, the hardest part of the work is already done. After that, everything is implementation. That's not the way the United States works.
That happened probably not in Notting Hill, but in that window sort of over there.
So what we have to do is we have to do those 15 people 150 times in many different cities. This is beginning, that we've got a network in Washington of people who are meeting and talking, and although we disagree, or at least we're agreeing to agree. And we now have to take our little network to other centers. And we have to find in San Diego, in Seattle, in the mouth of the Hudson, there are people who feel alone, and we have to help them find their local networks. And then we have to connect these local networks into a national network of Republicans, and not just thinkers, but activists and donors, and we have to get them to agree something must change. Once you've agreed that something must change, the next step is, so what's that something? And that's when you begin to need institutions. I mean, I have a program, I laid it out in the written three books since I started on this path. One was a policy book in 2007. The second was, of all things, a novel that sort of is a satire of how the Tea Party got the upper hand. And then, you know, most recently, the Romney book, Diagnosing What Went Wrong. So I've laid out my program, but other people have other programs. So the people who want change and reform then begin to talk in a serious way about what that looks like. So you start with the network, you progress to the institutions, and now you need to begin to support actual candidates who are adequately funded and who are ensconced in activist networks that will work for them. You know, when the last time the Republican Party had a real fight over this kind of direction, back in the middle 1960s, the party was split over the issue of the Civil Rights Act. Republicans support it or oppose it, and the Goldwater people said oppose it, and the modern Republicans said support it. And the modern Republicans won that contest by being as well organized and as tough and as willing and as determined to win as their opposite numbers. Then came the social convulsions of the 60s, then the civil rights issue seemed to go into abeyance, and then the right wing of the party developed ever more ascendancy in the 90s, and especially after the unsuccess of the Bush years. They were more organized, they were more committed, they went to the meetings, and they had a greater will to win. And you can't win unless you care at least as much as the people you're struggling against.
Dave, I just want to ask you a question about the changing nature of the electorate and its engagement with the issues of the day. Neil Postman wrote a book about change in the cultural, written cultural, broadcast culture. We now have a digital culture where things just flit across the surface of the electorate's brains. In Italy, we've just had the election of a comedian with 45% vote. Strange things are happening in elections. What are your thoughts about the evolution of those things, and in particular, we've got really serious problems in our world, and the electorate needs to engage with those problems. It seems to be less and less willing to engage with them.
Yes. On my mother's side of the family, I come from a long line of retailers, and so I have absorbed this attitude that the customer is always right, not because the customer is always right, but because the customer is always the customer. And it does no good to complain about the electorate's cognitive failures. First, because I think, one, there's a tendency to exaggerate them. There's a tendency among party activists. One of the things that I've noticed is the Republicans who are most committed, most active, they have very serious cognitive failures of their own. They believe all kinds of things about the universe that are not true. And they have a lot of information. It just unfortunately comes from the Wall Street Journal editorial page, so it's completely made up. My phrase for this is pretend facts and pseudo-information, and their heads are stuffed with it. Second, if voters are voting for comedians, as they did in Italy, as they just did in Italy, what a horrible reflection on the non-comedians. I mean, it is political elites everywhere that have failed. So I sometimes think of that. I don't mean this analogy in any way disrespectfully, but I sometimes think of the voter as one of those white lab mice in some horrible, sadistic, psychological experiment. The experiment begins teaching the lab mouse that if you press the red pellet, you get a button, you get a food pellet, and if you press the other button, you get zapped. And then some grad student says, well, what if the mouse gets zapped either way? What will happen? Well, then you get this frantic mouse that first, you know, presses both buttons, then refuses to press either, because it's nothing but pain. So if all the parties are agreed that no matter how you vote, the answer is you get the euro. Right? I mean, what is an Italian voter supposed to do? All they want is not to have a depression on anymore. They want work. They want their kids to find work. They want not to be poorer with every passing year. All the parties are the one thing, you know, we have important disagreements about traffic and, you know, but the one thing we all agreed is this depression must last forever. We agree on that. So, of course, they're going to vote for a comedian. And in the United States, In the United States, we had, you know, I think we had quite a high level of voter engagement, but it really is amazing how much consensus we have on how powerful class prejudice has become as a force for example. And in the United States, the immigration issue is a perfect example of this. That both parties have agreed that whatever else is wrong with America in 2013, one thing we can agree on is the country does not have enough low-wage HELOT labor. And we need to import a whole lot more of that because the cost of having doormen and nannies is just out of control. And that is just a universal consensus among people with access to major media. But meanwhile, the country is full of people who think the cost of labor is too low. We don't see low, we see low wages as a problem to be solved, not as as a path of development to be followed. So yes, look, voter ignorance is a real thing. Voter ignorance is also a rational thing in many ways. But we need to be, I think we should not, we have the, in every other area of life, in every other aspect you deal with, people would say we deal with the most, we are living with the most sophisticated consumer of all time. Very good at making choices, very good at comparing prices. And everywhere else, information technology is a tool of personal empowerment. And whatever your line of business is, that you find you're dealing with smarter, more sophisticated, and they're willing to pay more for things too. You can prove that, if you can prove that your product is better, you can, Apple computers cost more than other brands, but they're better, and so you can persuade people that it's worth the money, and they will part with it. In politics alone, do we say, well, if they don't like what we're selling, it's because they're too dumb to appreciate how good it is.
Hi, I'm Stuart Wood from the Labour Party. I want to ask you a question about money. When the Citizens United judgment came down, the Democrats thought that it was going to be systematically a problem for them compared to Republicans. But is there not a case? I wonder what you think of the argument that the campaign finance law is the kind of unwitting ally of the reinforcement of Tea Party Republicanism and stopping essentialist Republicanism from emerging. And if it is a question of money, where is the money for a centrist Republicanism going to come from in the future?
That's a very good question. I think you're right that the money has been spent in ways that entrench Tea Party style conservatism, although the people who are giving big checks are not at all Tea Party people. Within the Republican world. It has the effect of changing the way the consultants think, because the consultants are getting commissions on this money. And so if you have somebody who says, I want to write a check for $100 million about how Barack Obama is a dangerous Muslim socialist, and if you make the ads, you get 15%. They'll make the ads. And the fact that hurts the party, it's not a matter of, they still get the $15 million either way. But here's another fact about these cases that you need to bear in mind. We have the now limitless spending on advertising, but there remain very stringent limits on the funds for the parties, and it is only the parties who can do everything else. So what you get is a political culture in which there is more and more advertising, but less and less of other things. And the political scientists tell us, are discovering now renewed appreciation for how powerful non-advertising means of political communication are, including door knocking. It turns out to be the single most powerful thing you can do. And especially if you have a door knocker who is in some ways demographically like the person. Young people in young neighborhoods, old people in old neighborhoods. Don't send those Howard Dean maniacs into Iowa. That's why, because they don't like them. Send Iowa people into Iowa who know how to talk, with following the local etiquette and social customs. But one of the things that went wrong organizationally, the Barack Obama had regular hard money donations that could fund a door knocking operation. The Republicans had massive amounts of advertising, but they didn't have the party funds. And it also seems that advertising does have a point of diminishing returns. That the first, third, fifth ad have impact, but especially if it's a negative ad, you reiterate too often, and what you end up doing is suppressing voter turnout because people just become convinced that the whole political system is hopelessly corrupt.
Thank you.
just all right. So yeah. Right, right, sorry. It's fine, but you just need to speak up a little bit. Thank you. Sorry about that.
Hi, I'm Walker Ferguson from Imperial College. There's been a lot said about the ecosystem of sort of the right-wing media and also of sort of the inarticulate communication done. Do you see the media sort of the right-wing being able to be used as a tool towards bringing in more people from the moderates, or do you think it's going to only keep the extremist side going?
Well, that's an open-ended question. One of the things that has been an interesting question mark since the election is Rupert Murdoch now has a Twitter feed. And every once in a while, he tweets something that makes you realize he's not as right-wing as Fox News. And if that's a curious observation for me, think how disconcerting it is for the hosts on Fox News. So he's indicated he's open to some approaches to gun control, that he is an immigration liberalizer. Does that lead to a change in attitude down below? Countervailing that is the recognition that Fox News is not a political operation. It is an entertainment vehicle, and it is concerned with ratings. Now, its ratings have been under pressure since the election, partly because of the spectacular election night meltdown of Karl Rove, which led people, it just became, the network sort of admitted that the whole thing was a con. And the firing of Dick Morris was a kind of admission. The firing of Sarah Palin was a kind of admission. And the old Fox News would never, what are you talking about? No, but they've now, as they've adjusted, that it's had an impact on their audience. But if, to the extent that they're in the entertainment business, they have a demographic they serve. It's a shrinking demographic, but it's still pretty good. And they make a lot of money, more than just about anybody else. However, if their entertainment imperatives, if the audience really does, if what has happened since the election is not just a post-election malaise, but really portends shifts in the way Americans consume news information, it may be. It may be. Talk radio, on the other hand, the incentives are all hopeless, because the talk radio audience has already been shrinking quite fast, and talk radio hosts have tried to counteract this by getting people to listen longer. And the way talk radio counts its audience, if someone who had been listening for 12 minutes now listens for 24, that counts as if he's doubled the audience. So you make it spicier and more inflammatory. And that's, it's my perception, but I think there are many, it is a widely shared one, that talk radio has become a lot more provocative since 2005 than before, a lot more openly racist. And Rush Limbaugh, the most famous of the talk radio hosts, is much more racially provocative today than he was a decade ago. And that has, I think, to do with the need to keep his audience listening longer in the face of an adverse audience. He's got the oldest audience, I think, of any major broadcast outlet in America, or any major information vehicle in America. He's got the oldest. The median age is 73. I don't quote that, I think that's right.
Hi. Scary. Hi. I'm a white, educated woman, American. Would have been Terry.
What can we do for you?
And my name is my name is Terry Duyon, and I would consider myself so fiscally more conservative, socially more liberal, and would have been more on the Republican side and find them quite scary today, because I think the socially conservative element of the Republican Party seems more extreme, possibly more vocal. And I'm just wondering about the demographics of that element of the Republican Party. Are they more vocal? Are they bigger? Are they growing? Or are they just becoming louder because the whole world seems to be becoming slightly more socially liberal? I mean, what's going on there? Because they're scary.
Yeah. Well, look, the recession is obviously a huge part of what is going on. Everyone feels more desperate. And political extremism does rise in bad economic times. Then the rising cost of health care means that we are increasingly in a zero-sum competition for health care dollars. So President Obama proposed to spend more on younger people browner people. 27% of the uninsured at the time of the passing of the Affordable Care Act were foreign-born. So when you transfer, you are covering immigrants. The three quarters are not immigrants, but more than one quarter are. And then lastly is the effect of this media. There's also the effect of the digital communication in this way. It used to be that, and this does not apply just to politics, that in every town there was a crazy person who believed that person was alone in the world. And now that crazy person has got thousands of digital friends, and they feel empowered. And whether it's I don't believe in vaccination for measles, whether it's I think that genetically modifying all the foods that have not been genetically modified by farmers over the past 10,000 years, that will make us sick. Whatever your craziness is, you now have a support group for your craziness. I think those are the factors that drive it. But I would emphasize one other thing, which is people like you and me, we have been too negligent. I don't know you don't know me. We should be organizing too. And so the next phase of what I want to do, I've written three books since 2000. What I want to do now is not write so many more books, but actually do more organizational work. Because if you're not prepared, Danny kindly described me a minute ago as brave, which I will quote then to deny, honestly deny. But the point is, actually, that whole attitude is the wrong way. Remember that great line from the movie Patton, that the object of battle is not to die for your country, but for some poor other dumb bastard to die for his country? That the object should be to organize things so they have to be brave. That to make it more difficult for them, for them to understand that if your view is that a child of rape should be brought to delivery, that's really we're going to make that a really high risk thing for you not only to say but to think.
Got time, unfortunately, for just the one question. So the gentleman with the pen here. Yeah. I'm so sorry for everyone else.
In that case, if I'm the last speaker, I just ask a question. I just want to say thank you. It's been absolutely fascinating. But let me move to the question. I'm an affiliate of quite an interesting voting laboratory. I'm the only person in my family who does not allow to vote in the United States elections. And I essentially got three Cameroonians in the family, but they all voted Democrat this time. And they weren't voting against Romney, they weren't particularly voting for Obama. They were absolutely explicitly voting against the Republican Party. And it all boiled down to one word, which this lady I think here was getting to, which is women. And you touched on it at the very beginning of your remarks, but you then moved on from it. And I would just observe that when I went to Greenwich, where I have Republican friends and Democrat friends, it seemed to me that this issue of how the Republican Party was actually toxic towards half the population was actually really, really serious. And actually possibly more important than the ethnic issues you have dwelt on. I wonder if you could come back on this issue of gender. Thank you.
All right, well, it can't be more important, so thank you. So you're British and you're married to an American and you have American daughters. Is that?
One of each.
The toxicity is both a function of Republican stance on what might be, they're not really women's issues, but on the issues of reproduction and sexual freedom and so on. That's problem number one. But problem number two is that Republicans have adopted a brand of high risk consequences be damned politics that are frightening to women voters. And they've also adopted an unofficial version of libertarian ideology. One of the tweets that got me into more trouble, I said there had been a discussion on one of the libertarian websites about why libertarianism is so unattractive to women. And I answered, well, that's because probably most women feel they already spend enough time dealing with toddlers. But the essence of libertarianism is I want. And no one should stop me from having what I want. And you know, women who have children spend a lot of time dealing with people where their mission is to explain to them you can't have what you, sometimes you can't have what, usually you can't have what you want. You live in a world populated by other human beings. So it's not just, and I think one of the things that the Republican leadership, and they're not ready for this, but they have to understand, it's not just a matter of telling your pro-life people to stop with their fascination with these horrible hypotheticals. It's not just to stop talking about abortion in a way that reveals that what you're really interested in is policing women. And it's not just the abortion issue, because you're going to be a pro-life party. By the way, women are more likely in the United States to be pro-life than men are. You can talk about that. There is a pro-life message that is attractive to women voters. When you say, you know, we used to have 1.5 million abortions a year in the United States. We now have 1.2 million. That's 300,000 less. There's a lot of science, social science on what it would take to get us down to 900,000 abortions. You know, it's a function of economic stability. It's a mother's allowances. There are things you can do to reduce the number of abortions. And that is a politics that I don't know if it's still true that the German social democrats get more votes, that in Germany the gender gap is reverse from what that used to be true. But it's because the Germans had this, you know, natalist family support approach to public policy that's very attractive to women voters. But even beyond all of that is just when you threaten to go bankrupt to make a point, that's a women's issue too. That's behavior that's off-putting to everybody, but it's even more off-putting to women because they don't like eyeball-to-eyeball, high-testosterone games for their own sake. I agree with you. It's very important. I think probably the problem will not ultimately be solved until you have many more women in positions of Republican leadership, and women who arise spontaneously. Because what a lot of the Tea Party people will say is, well, hey, we do have lots of women. We have the Sarah Palin and so on. But those are women who do not rise on their own by their own efforts. So they are chosen by powerful male party leaders for reasons that are heavily sexualized. I mean, there's just no getting around. That was what was going on in the Sarah Palin case. And then they are then elevated artificially, arrive in positions for which they are unprepared. Maybe they could have been, some of them might have been prepared had they had a more natural ascent, others will never be prepared. And they are there then performing to a male audience in a male style. But when we have women rising sort of more organically, that you will see, and you see this with some of the women in Congress, you certainly see this with the senatorial candidates, people like Meg Whitman, Carly Fiorina. They did not adopt the confrontational, high-risk, reckless politics of the rest of the party. And I think in both cases, the defeat of Carly Fiorina in particular, maybe, you know, one looks back at that was a real lost opportunity. She would be an important force in the U.S. Senate if she were there.
I was told that if I ran out of steam with David Frum, I could finish before 1:45, and I didn't think that was very likely to happen, and so it proved. Can I thank all of you for your questions, because you're clapping yourself at the moment. Can I thank all of you for very good questions, which unusually in audiences were not speeches with question marks at the end, but real questions. David, I said you were brave. I did actually mean that. I think you have been and are very brave, but also witty, articulate. You have shoes that always look extraordinarily like you've just put them on for the very first time. It's a mystery that I certainly can't solve in my life, and I'm putting my feet quite carefully underneath my chair. Policy Exchanges, very proud to have you, even more proud to be your friend. We're always pleased to host you. You've been scintillating today, not just good. I hope that everyone has enjoyed it. I know they have as much as I have.